61st session of the Senate, in the first regular session of the 17th Congress, is hereby called to order. Senator Sherwin Gatchalian will lead us in prayer.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day as we all gather here today. In your name, we ask for divine guidance and wisdom as we seek your will for our beloved nation, knowing that public service is ultimately service unto you. Give us courage and strength as we endeavor to do what is right before you and our countrymen. Your word declares, "Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord." We humbly ask you today that you bless our nation, the Senate, and all our government institutions. May everything we say and do bring honor and glory to you. We thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Senator Gatchalian. The Himig Antonio of St. Anthony Academy of Quezon City will lead us in the singing of the Philippine National Anthem. The group will also render a song entitled Tayo'y Mga Pinoy.
Bayang mag-iliw, peres na sinangalan, alam ng puso sa dibdib mo'y buhay. Lupang hinirang, duyan ka ng mangiting, sa manlulupig, di ka masisingin. Sa dagat at bundok, sa simula, sa langit mong lugaw, may dilagang tunatawid sa paglayang minamahal. Ang kisap ng wataw at mo'y tarumpay na nagtilimin. Ang bituin at araw niyang kailan pa may di magdidilim. Lupa ng araw ng buwan at ipasinta mo'y langit sa piling mo. Aming ligaya ng pag may makaapi ang mamatay ng dahil sa'yo.
Thank you. Maraming salamat po sa Himig Antonio. Secretary, please call the roll.
Roll call of members. The Honorable Senators Angara, Aquino, Binay, Cayetano, De Lima, Drilon, Ejercito, Escudero, Gatsalian, Gordon, Honasan, Hontiveros, Lacson, Ligarda, Pacquiao, Pangilinan, Po, Recto, Soto, Prilianis, Villanueva, Villar, Zoveri, Senate President Pimentel.
With 22 senators present, the chair declares the presence of a quorum.
Mr. President, it's the birthday of Senator Francis Escudero. May we suspend the session for 1 minute to be
able
to...
Session is suspended.
Mr. President, we're in.
Session is resumed.
Thank you. Mr. President, I move that we dispense with the reading of the journal of the 30th session, Wednesday, October 5, 2016, and consider the same as approved.
Is there any objection? There being none, the motion to dispense with the reading of the journal of the 30th session, Wednesday, October 5, 2016, and consider the same as approved is hereby approved.
Mr. President, before we proceed with the reference of business, we'd like to acknowledge some guests in the Senate. We have the constitutional law students of the Universidad de Manila, led by its class president, Ms. Vergara. Bachelor in Mass Communication students from University de Manila with Professor Caber. Philippine National University officers, Dr. Ojena, Dr. Monte Alegre, Dr. Reyes. The guests of Senator Villanueva, Mr. De La Vega of the United Continents Philippines, Ms. Santos, Jocelyn Santos, and Ms. United Continents 2016. Also, we have the guests of Senator Cayetano, Board Member Paulo Crisostomo, ABC of Cavite, and Nicolits Montessori Humanities School, Humanities and Social Sciences, headed by Ms. Tianco. And we have the guests also of Senator Cayetano, Mr. President, the Philippine Superliga F2 Logistics PSL Manila team, and the officials of the PSL in Event Court. And at this point, may we recognize Senator Alan Cayetano to tell us more of who our guests are, Mr. President. I'll give way to
Senator Cayetano is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. President. Magandang hapon po and dear colleagues. The Bible tells us kung ano ang ating itatanim, yan din ang ating anihin. A welcome break pero konektado pa rin sa war against drug, ay athletics or sports. Our brother in Christ, our dear senator and yung pambansang Kamao who is known worldwide, idolized worldwide, has come forward recently to say that once upon a time, drugs also affected his life. But through boxing, through sports, to finding Christ in his heart, he has found the right way. Today, Mr. President, we have with us, and we are privileged as a country to host for the very first time, the FIVP, Federation Internationale Volleyball, World's Club World Championship. In other words, Mr. President, yung World's Club World Championship is the NBA. Kung ang basketball ay may NBA, ang FIVP Women's World Cup is the counterpart. This much-awaited competition in the world of volleyball will feature some of the best volleyball players, including our very own. It is then my privilege to welcome also the PSL F2 Logistics Manila team, or the Philippine team, to the Senate of the Philippines. This roster of best and brightest volleyball stars are expected to shine as they represent the Philippines in their prestigious sporting event. Shown, Mr. President, on the screen are pictures of the Philippine team. Beyond their achievements in sports, these players are role models in terms of their lifestyle, their practice of fair play and cultural camaraderie, and their overall positive attitude in life. As host, our country is provided with a rare opportunity to field a team in this tournament. We are proud to say that the PSL F2 Logistics Manila team will aim to show that they can compete among the best in the world. Sir President, usually po, ang World Championship has four of the best teams. Ito yung seeded club teams, professional players po, and then the three wildcard teams. But for the first time, because of the committee who will introduce later on, they were able to negotiate with FIVP to include the host team, which will be the Philippine team that is now on the screen. Our homegrown talent, especially, will benefit in the top-level competition as we hope to actively return as a medal contender in the Southeast Asian Games and become a regular competitor in the FIVP and AVC tournaments. Sir President, may I have the opportunity to introduce some of the players and then ask for a photo opportunity with the senators afterwards. Let me start with the head coach, Mr. Mora Branislav. Our head coach are here with you today. He's also a world-renowned volleyball head coach. Then we have Takahashi Shun, assistant coach. We have Ponce de Leon as our team manager, George Pascua as our trainer, Paulina Tomas as our physical therapist, Ian Fernandez, our trainer too. For the players, Mr. President, let me start with Tichaya Bunlert. The pictures are on the screen. Fukuda Yuri, Ekaterina Krivets, Yevgenia Nyukalova, Lindsay Statzer, Linda Morales, Stephanie Niemer, Rachel Ann Dakis, Micah Arin Reyes, Jenilyn Reyes, Frances Zinia Molina, Kim Fajardo, Jaja Santiago, Jovelyn Gonzaga, and as the chairman of the Philippine Superliga, Philip Huico, the Director General of Superliga, Ramon Tat Susara, our Evercourt General Director, Mr. Sigbert Bruchin, and Evercourt Marketing Director, Dominic Stav. Lastly, we also have, last but not the least, the team sponsor and president of F2 Logistics, together also with his family and staff, Mr. Efren Uy. Sir President, we have among us Olympic and World Championship medalists. I will not go one by one on their achievements because we are all anticipating their play first. But it would be a great honor for us if they will be back here after the tournament that will be held in 18 to 23. Let me just take note that this World Championship event is a vote of confidence in the Philippines. While I do not want to say na kapag ka meron pong sports event or event na natuloy sa Pilipinas, sasabihin, boto kay Duterte. Pag may umatras, eh, problema kasi sa presidente natin. Let us just say that it is the vote of confidence in the Philippines and the Filipino people. Malacanang fully through its support to ensure the success of this country's hosting of this event. Memorandum Circular Number 9 was issued by Executive Secretary Salvador Miguel Diaz dated October 5 and President Rodrigo Duterte tasked all government agencies to provide support to the prestigious volleyball festival, which is a big boost to the country's tourism program. A draft executive order is in the desk of President Duterte, and we hope that the full support that we are all asking for will be given by all the agencies. Mr. President, in the area of tourism, just as an example, Mr. President, the state visit to China is coming up. Thailand gets about 9 million, almost 10 million Chinese tourists a year. Secretary Durano, during his time, said that he focused on our neighbors because it is easier to get them as tourists. We are getting 500,000. This tournament will be broadcast worldwide. Volleyball fans throughout the world will be watching, and many parts of our country will be featured here. Sir President, while it is true that true change comes from the change of values and spiritual reformation, just like our brother Manny Pacquiao, remember that sports and athletes represent discipline, represent values that include leadership, integrity, teamwork, and camaraderie. So, Mr. President, may we welcome today, and may I ask for a minute suspension so that they may have the opportunity for a photo with the Senate President and with the Senators. Thank you, Mr. President, and welcome to our Philippine team.
Thank you, Senator Cayetano. And to all our guests, welcome to the Philippine Senate.
May I ask for a minute suspension?
Yes, is there any objection? Hearing none, session is suspended.
Thank you.
Eh, nakaharap ko. Meron pa yata isang celebrity doon na nakaharang. Hindi, hindi nila maintindihan. Kahit pagpukin ko, hindi nila maintindihan eh. So, i-guide mo dapat sila. Session is resumed.
Thank you, Mr. President. Because we have accommodated the Philippine team, with the consent of the chamber, I move for the consideration of PS Resolution 175.
Is there any objection? Hearing none, PS Resolution number 175 is in order.
May we ask the Secretary to read the title of the measure without prejudice to inserting into the records the entire text of the resolution.
Secretary. Resolution recognizing and commending Giseline Santos for being crowned as the Miss United Continents 2016.
President, I move that we recognize Senator Joel Villanueva, the principal author of the resolution, to sponsor the measure.
Is there an objection? Hearing none, Senator Villanueva is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Majority Floor Leader. Thank you, Mr. President. My dear colleagues, isang mapagpalang araw sa ating lahat. Noong pong kabataan ako, isang lumang arko ang palagi kong nadadaanan sa aming probinsya sa Bulacan. Ang pagkakaalala ko po, ang nakatitik po doon sa arko ay maligayang pagdating sa lalawigan ng Bulacan, bayan ng magigiting na bayani at magagandang dilag. Patutunayan po ito ngayong hapon ng bisita natin ngayon sa Senado. Isang magiting at magandang dilag mula sa Hagonoy, Bulacan, si Jesslyn Santos, a Bulakenya, a beauty queen, a youth leader, an athlete, and the reigning Miss United Continents 2016. Mr. President, it's my honor to sponsor Senate Resolution 175 commending and congratulating Jesslyn Santos, a kababayan from Bulacan and a member of the Kristiyanong Kabataan para sa Bayan Movement or KKB, one of the biggest youth organizations in the country chaired by this representation, for being crowned as the Miss United Continents 2016 at Guayaquil, Ecuador on September 24, 2016. The Miss United Continents, like Miss World, Miss Universe, and other globally recognized beauty competitions, is an annual beauty pageant with participants from all over the world. Jesslyn is the first Filipina and the first Asian to win the title, Mr. President. Mr. President, I believe that these competitions give every Filipina an opportunity to enhance their self-confidence, to become more empowered and independent. At sa bawat Filipino beauty queen na kinikilala sa plenaryong ito, Mr. President, nabibigyan kung hindi man lumalawak ang puwang sa ating lipunan ng milyong-milyong kababaihang lumalaban para sa kanilang sarili, para sa kanilang pamilya at para sa inang bayan. Ang ganito pong pagkilala ay nag-aangat sa kanilang dignidad at sa mga dakilang bagay na kayang isipin at gawin ng bawat Pinay. There is no doubt, Mr. President, the modern Filipina today is truly global, multicultural, and God-fearing. Global, at masasabi kong proud po ako kay Jesslyn sa kanyang talino at sipag bilang mag-aaral, kasabay ng pagiging volleyball athlete sa Bulacan State University. Ang tagumpay niya ay patunay sa dekalidad at globally competitive na edukasyon sa bansa, lalo na po Ginoong Pangulo sa ating mga state universities. Multicultural, pinag-uusapan po kasi sa social media ang paggamit ni Jesslyn ng wikang Espanyol, ang opisyal na wika sa Ecuador, sa question and answer portion ng kompetisyon. Ito po'y pagpapakita sa mundo na multilingual ang mga Pilipino. Tulad po ng mga kababayan nating OFWs at BPO workers dito sa Pilipinas, pinatotohanan niyang anumang wika, kayang gamitin ng Pilipino. Sa iba't ibang kultura man, kayang iangkop ng Pilipino ang kanyang sarili. God-fearing, sapagkat palagi ko pong binabanggit sa mga miyembro ng Kristiyanong Kabataan para sa Bayan Movement o KKB, kung saan miyembro si Jesslyn, yung nakasaad po sa banal na kasulatan sa Book of Proverbs chapter 3 verse 6 that in everything you do, put God first and He will direct you and crown your efforts with tremendous success. Ang tagumpay po ni Jesslyn ay patunay ng pagsasabuhay ng kanyang pananampalataya. Paalala sa ating mga kabataang Pilipino na makakamit ang tagumpay kung ang Panginoon ang sentro ng ating buhay. Being globally competitive, multicultural, and God-fearing, Mr. President, beauty queens like Jesslyn Santos depict who a Filipina is and what our nation should be in the global stage. Mr. President, ang bandila ng Pilipinas at ang dangal ng lahing Pilipino ang daladala ni Miss United Continents 2016, Jesslyn Santos sa Ecuador. Dala po niya ang buong bansa. Tagumpay po ito ng bawat Pilipino. Maraming salamat po at mabuhay ang ating Senado.
Thank you, Senator Villanueva.
Mr. President.
Majority Leader.
This is a very a great feat for a Filipina. May I be allowed to ask one or two questions if the gentleman from Bulacan will yield?
Definitely, of course, Mr. President.
Just interested in the second, whereas the 23-year-old broadcast communications graduate from Hagonoy, Bulacan, charmed her way to the crown with an impressive speech in Spanish. Does the lady speak Spanish, Mr. President?
Mr. President, I was told that she trained before the beauty pageant, and she trained for about 3 months, and she was able to answer eloquently during the question and answer portion of the competition.
Very good. Thank you very much. I just wanted to know that. But she did not study Spanish during her elementary or high school days, Mr. President?
No, Mr. President. She did not.
All right. Thank you very much. Mr. President, Senator Pacquiao wishes to co-sponsor the measure, but I move that the speech be inserted into the records instead as requested by Senator Pacquiao.
Thank you, Mr.
If there is no objection, the co-sponsorship speech of Senator Pacquiao will be inserted into the records.
Thank you, Mr. President. I Move to adopt PS Resolution 175, subject to style.
Is there any objection? Hearing none, proposed Senate Resolution number 175 is adopted, subject to style.
Maybe a 1 minute suspension, Mr. President, to congratulate.
1 minute suspension.
Ms. Continence.
Kasi yung kanina.
Senator Soto, Senator De Lima, Senator Frank Villalor. Thank you.
Session resumed.
Mr. President, to speak on a matter of public interest, may we recognize Senator Juan Miguel Zubiri?
Is there any objection? Hearing none, Senator Zubiri is recognized to speak on a matter of public interest.
Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. President, from the beautiful, now to the ugly. Mr. President, I would like to take this opportunity to discuss the Hajj pilgrimage passport controversy. The Hajj, Mr. President, is one of the five pillars of Islam. It is the annual pilgrimage of the holy city of Mecca, which each Muslim must undertake, Muslim must undertake at least once in his lifetime. Each year, millions of Muslims gather in Mecca for this religious ritual. This year, the date of Hajj began on September 9. Thus, as early as August, our brother Muslims started embarking on their journey to Mecca. On August 18, however, 177 prospective pilgrims were stopped in their tracks as they attempted to depart for the Philippines towards Saudi Arabia. The pilgrims were carrying Philippine passports or travel documents, so our immigration officials found it suspicious when they were unable to speak Filipino or any Filipino dialect. They were detained, and it was soon discovered that they were in fact not Filipinos, but Indonesian nationals who were carrying authentic, a bit fraudulently obtained, Philippine passports or travel documents, Mr. President. We commend the Bureau of Immigration Officers for their keen eyes, good judgment call for apprehending these Indonesians and unearthing this scam. The Indonesians are said to have paid as much as 131 million Indonesian rupiah, or about 460,000 pesos, at that time $10,000, to illegal travel agencies who facilitate their Hajj journey, which fee includes a Philippine passport, Mr. President. To better understand this issue, it is worthy to know that Saudi Arabia allocates a Hajj quota for each country with a Muslim population in order to limit the number of pilgrims who arrive each year. Indonesia, Mr. President, having the largest Muslim population in the world, quickly fills up its quota. As such, Indonesians must wait up to 37 years before they can perform the Hajj. Contrast that with the Philippines, where our Hajj quota is rarely filled. Thus, in this practice of foreign Muslims using Filipino passports was derived. Some of our Filipino Muslim brothers, Mr. President, reveal that the Philippine delegation to Mecca during Hajj always includes foreign nationals. Unscrupulous people have taken advantage of the situation by coming up with an elaborate scheme to provide fraudulent passports to prospective pilgrims. Mr. President, this is a highly disturbing scheme and should be a very huge cause of concern for our country. How were non-Filipinos able to obtain Philippine passports when many of our own countrymen have difficulty doing so? A passport is not only supposed to be one of the most reliable forms for identification, it is also proof of citizenship. It is an official state-issued document which, under our laws, remains at all times the property of government. Thus, our Philippine passport access, no passport shall be issued to an applicant unless the secretary or his duly authorized representative is satisfied that the applicant is a Filipino citizen who has complied with the requirements prescribed by law. Other states likewise trust that our passports are genuine and reliable documents bearing truthful information. This fraudulent scheme damages the integrity of our passports and casts doubt on its reliability. In other words, Mr. President, nakakahiya po ito sa international community. Further, as a principal sponsor of Republic Act 9997, which establishes the National Commission on Muslim Filipinos, I am alarmed at the report saying that the passports were issued on the strength of certifications issued by the NCMF. The NCMF facilitates the Hajj pilgrimage of Filipino Muslims, ensuring that they fall within the Hajj quota. In short, all Filipino Muslims must go through the NCMF in order to perform the Hajj. Has the NCMF been so careless, or is the procedure so lax that they issue certifications to non-Filipinos? Or are they more deeply involved in this fraudulent processing scheme which has allegedly been institutionalized in the commission? During the committee deliberations on the NCMF law, Mr. President, I made it on record and raised these issues both in the committee hearings and private meetings of then the leaders of the Office of Muslim Affairs, or OMA, the predecessors of the NCMF. My fear, during those hearings, I told them that my fear was that the Hajj pilgrimage could be used by NCMF officials for corruption. I have issued a stern warning to then OMA officials not to use their office for corruption during the Hajj pilgrimage process and not use it as a tool to enrich themselves. Mr. President, my fear now is happening. I remember during the hearings, I had told them issues about their travel kits of Hajj pilgrims being sold by one or two directors of the OMA, being sold by the OMA itself, and they could not buy it anywhere else. I was also told of instances at that time that all the Hajj pilgrims must buy their tickets from only one or two accredited travel agencies by the Office of Muslim Affairs. They could not buy it anywhere else for obvious racketeering or for money-making purposes. Likewise, other official documents such as birth certificates were allegedly issued by local civil registrars as part of the requirements to obtain the passports. I wish to stress, Mr. President, that these are not fake, but genuine documents containing false information which were issued by government offices. The other day, Mr. President, I had a chance to meet with the ambassador of Britain. And when I told him about this racket, because he happens also to be a brother Muslim, and when I told him about the racket, he said, if that happened in Great Britain, many heads of agencies would have been removed and criminal charges would have been charged with these particular government officials. So, Mr. President, if the reports we gathered are true, why did the Department of Foreign Affairs allow the issuance of passports without requiring the personal appearance of the applicant? We Filipinos have to comply with the strict rules for passport issuance. We appear personally before the officials of the DFA, submit the proper documents, wait in line, like I have waited in line many times to renew my passport, to have our photo and biometrics taken, and sometimes wait for months before our passport is finally issued. Yes, it is true, Senator Legarda. I had to wait in line. And yet, this entire process was unceremoniously abandoned in favor of crooked individuals who take advantage of other people in order to make big bucks. Has there been a grand connivance among private persons and government agencies, from the LGU to the NSO to the National Commission of Muslim Filipinos, all the way up to the Department of Foreign Affairs, Mr. President, to facilitate this fraudulent scheme? Mr. President, the Indonesian Minister of Foreign Affairs has alluded to this as an organized criminal activity. What if a similar scheme or group, same group of unscrupulous individuals, will be in cahoots in exchange for large sums of money with terrorist organizations and facilitate the issuance of Philippine passport to international terrorists? I cannot imagine what kind of damage it will bring our country and our passporting system. Thus, I urge this chamber to direct the proper Senate committee, and I would like to ask Mr. President and the Majority Floor Leader, if it could be the Blue Ribbon Committee, to conduct an investigation on this matter. There is a real and urgent need to put a halt on this elaborate scheme, which involves government officers and employees who make a mockery of the official processes and, in effect, prey on our Muslim brethren, as well as jeopardize and compromise our country's primary travel document, making it an easy accessory for the perpetration of crime and acts of terrorism. Thank you very much, Mr. President. Thank you very much to the Senate.
Thank you, Senator Subiri.
Majority Leader. President, may we recognize the President Pro Tem to interpellate the gentleman?
Senator Drilon is recognized for interpellation.
Thank you, Mr. Majority Leader. Thank you, Mr. President. Will the gentleman from Bukidnon yield a few questions?
I would be honored, Mr. President, to answer questions of the Senate President Pro Tem.
First of all, let me extend my congratulations to the gentleman from Bukidnon, Mr. President, for bringing to our attention this really dangerous and anomalous practice of issuing passports to non-Filipinos. I have no doubt that given the magnitudes of the and the number of passports issued, a syndicate somewhere is operating, even beyond our shores and possibly in Indonesia. But first, a general question. Would the gentleman be aware if an investigation is presently ongoing on this anomalous practice?
Yes, Mr. President. I believe the NBI, together with the DFA, are already coordinating with each other. The lead agency for the investigation is the National Bureau of Investigation.
Would the gentleman be at liberty to share with us and spread it to the record the initial results of the investigation, if any?
Wala pa po, Mr. President. They haven't given us any details. That's the reason why we'd like to call for a hearing on this matter, because we would not like it to be swept under the rug again, as many other investigations have happened in the past.
I agree with the gentleman from Bukidnon. In fact, we should look at our Philippine Passport Act to figure out how this had happened and what amendments should be introduced in order to prevent such practice from happening again. And would the gentleman be able to tell this body when this happened, this particular case of
177
passports were issued?
They were apprehended on August 18, attempting to leave the Philippines for Saudi Arabia. August 18. 2016. This year,
August 18.
This year, yes, sir.
Yes.
August 18, po.
Yes. And I assume the passports were issued before that time.
Yes, sir, Your Honor.
And that's indicated in the individual passports.
Yes, Your Honor. Yes, Mr.
Now, is this the first time it happened, or is this the first time it was caught?
Actually, Mr. President, this is the first time they were caught, but they've been, recently, another batch was caught again. A few weeks ago, another batch of, I remember 12, August 20, there were 12 others. I read about 2 weeks ago, during the month of September, another 12 pilgrims were caught when they entered the Philippines, showing their Filipino passports. The Filipino Bureau of Immigration agents talked to them. Again, they were not able to speak Filipino. And so they were carried to the side, brought to the side, and they were found out to be Indonesians as well, Mr. President. And I believe also Malaysians. And under our report, it's not only Filipinos, as well as some Malaysians were caught with the travel documents.
Now, this is subsequent to August 18, when for the first time 177 passports were confiscated from these alleged Filipino citizens.
Yes, Mr. President. And just for the information of the Senate President Pro Tem, some of my staff are Muslims, and they've attended Hajj pilgrimage, and they've told me that it is not uncommon that part of the Filipino delegation were actually foreigners. During their time, and this was several years ago. So this has been ongoing for the past several years.
And apparently from the way, okay, let me withdraw that question. Firstly, would the gentleman be able to tell us at this stage who are the travel agencies involved?
I would not have an idea, Your Honor. My apologies to the Senate President. But the process is that the NCMF will release you the certification that these are the official pilgrims. They will now go to the Department of Foreign Affairs to apply for their passports, because under the guise that many of our Muslim brothers in the armed area do not have the travel documents. So even their NSO birth certificates that have been forged are brand new. And so they rely only on the information coming from the NCMF. And then the Department of Foreign Affairs issues the documentation. And there are irregularities, because some of the DFA, some of the passporting offices, the DFA Regional Passporting Office, allow non-appearance before their office here. We gather that the applicants will not need to appear before the DFA Regional Passporting Office for their photos and biometrics. They'll just have to submit, with this racket, they'll just have to submit the photos. And then they get their passport documents.
So these are submitted in the regional offices of the DFA?
Yes, Your Honor.
Not here in the main office?
In the regional.
In the regional. Which region particularly?
The ARM region, Mr. President. And the Zamboanga, the region of Zamboanga.
So
Region 9.
The ARMM DFA office,
including Region
and
9,
the Zamboanga City regional office, yes, are the principal sources of the passports issued.
Yes, Mr. President.
Now, and do I understand it that the certification issued by the NCMF is a certification that these are pilgrims that are eligible to go to this annual pilgrimage?
Yes.
Is that the Mr. certification issued?
Yes, Mr. President.
And who submits the names of these people?
NCMF, they apply.
No, no. What
they
is
apply.
The source of the, and what is the basis of the NCMF in issuing a certification that say Mr. Dick Gordon is a Muslim?
Mr. President, I believe that there's an application. We have a quota, and I believe the quota for the Philippines every year is about 8,000 pilgrims. In Saudi Arabia and Indonesia, the quota is 168,800. It's always overbooked in Indonesia.
Yeah. And
so the 8,000.
For the Philippines?
Yes, Your Honor.
And where would the NCMF source the 8,000?
I would believe that people applying for the Hajj pilgrimage, because apparently what is being told here during the press releases and press comments is that it's never covered. The 8,000 is never covered. It's only about 5,000, 6,000. So I presume it is people applying for the Hajj pilgrimage coming from Muslim Mindanao. Mahal po kasi. It's an expensive endeavor, so not all Muslim
brothers. You're saying that, so the Indonesian holders of this Philippine passport would be carrying false Muslim identities of Muslims in southern Philippines?
Yes, Mr. President. That is what's happening.
Gagawa lang sila ng pangalan.
They have different names. Yes, Mr. President. They have fictitious names.
They are fictitious names.
Yes, Mr.
And
President.
Therefore, the birth certificates issued are also fictitious.
All fictitious, Mr. President.
Huh?
They're all fictitious.
They are fictitious. And the NCFF, I can imagine that what they will say is, we have received these documents and we process them, washing their hands on whatever responsibility.
But the responsibility of the NCFF is to certify that they're actually Filipino Muslims and not Indonesian Muslims. And so therefore, if they issue the certification and they're Indonesians, they have to be held liable.
Yeah. And what are they obligated to do before they issue the certification that they're Filipino Muslims? I mean, what is the NCMF personnel required to do before issuing the certification? Are they required to go to ARMM? Are they required to see a person whose name appears there? What?
In ARMM, Mr. President, the NCMF is, ano po yan, marami po silang opisina in every province on the ARM area. They have a very, if you look at the budget of the OMA, Mr. President, they have a lot of personnel. They even have NCMF officials here in Metro Manila taking charge of our brother Muslims in Taguig and in Manila. There's an NCR director for NCMF, there's a regional director for ARM, there's a regional director for Region 9. So what I would believe that they should be doing is getting in touch with their provincial directors to be able to verify if these are from this tribe, are they Maranaos, are they Maguindanaos, and then maybe getting the barangay certification. But I believe here's the, I was just given the listing of Hajj passport or the application for Hajj pilgrimage. Passport applicants was required to personally appear to any of the DFA authorized issuing agencies, DFA main office or regional consular office. Those with valid passports are not required to submit a birth certificate anymore authenticated by the National Statistics Office. New applicants who are able to comply with the documentary requirements prescribed by Article 6 of the said department order are automatically issued regular passports with the validity of 5 years. Yan lang po ang nakalagay dito. So it's mostly on the DFA. And that is why if we call the NCMF to the hearing, Mr. President, your question exactly will be my question. How do you vet out, how do you filter out the pilgrims? And how do you certify them? What is the certification? What is the standards for certification?
Because if I can already anticipate what DFA will say, they will assert that they simply relied on the certification of the NCMF that our Muslim brother, whose name appears there, is certified by the NCMF.
Oh, yes, sir, but under the passport processes, you still have to apply, you still have to go to the DFA office, make a personal visit, you have to line up, you have to have your picture taken. These people cannot speak English, they cannot even speak Tagalog or Cebuano, so mahuhuli talaga sila.
So it is not difficult to have a paper trail of this, because I assume the application is there, I assume the date when it was received is there, I assume that the personnel who received this is there, and all the necessary data should be on record in order to be able to trace who acted on these applications for Philippine passport and who simply allowed them to go through the process without even requiring, for example, the appearance of these applicants.
Absolutely, Mr. President. As a matter of fact, I just got information that some of the passports were issued at the DFA ASEANO office, right here.
Right here in
Macapagal Boulevard. And, with the 177 pilgrims that were apprehended, there were 5 Filipino handlers that were with them. They're now under the custody of the NBI. So maybe we can also ask the NBI through their interrogation what they've uncovered, if they were able to uncover, if any.
You would not have the names of the five Filipinos?
No, sir.
Who facilitated the fixers?
No,
sir. Who facilitated this?
Fortunately, no, sir.
No. Would you have on record the names of the consular officials who signed the passports or who processed these passports applications?
No, sir. Unfortunately,
we'll have to get this
yes, sir.
Information when we start hearing this.
Yes, Mr. President, we need to. Because this is such a scandal. It's such a... people, I'm so saddened that it hasn't really reached the magnitude of attention that it should have been given. It was always page 4, page 5 of the newspapers. But in other countries, this would have been a huge scandal of the Foreign Affairs Department or Ministry, including the Ministry handling the Hajj pilgrimage. And I don't want this to be another investigation swept under the rug, because apparently this has been happening, Mr. President, for a very long time. It's become endemic already to the Office of the Muslim Affairs and the National Commission for Muslim Filipinos, and they, of course, with partnership with the organized criminal minds in the DFA. So we should put a stop to this, Mr. President.
By the way, who is the head of the National Commission on Muslim Filipinos today, Mr. Chairman, Mr. President?
Secretary Bai Lau, if I'm not mistaken.
Who?
Secretary Lau. Secretary Lau. She's a Filipino-Chinese descent na Muslim.
And how long has she been, he or she?
She, it's a lady, Mr.
She.
President.
So how long, she's how been long when was she appointed?
Since it was, she's a carryover, sir, from the last administration.
All right. Anyway, Mr. President, I congratulate the gentleman from Bukidnon for bringing this to our attention, and indeed, this should be the concern of the chamber. It's as important as any other issue that we face today, because if this is not remedied, then you have Filipinos all over the world all kinds of citizens getting Philippine passports. It is unfortunate that this has happened, but I hope that we can get into the bottom of this. And in the meantime, maybe the chair of the Committee on Finance can suspend all deliberations on the budget of the NCMF until this matter can be properly investigated. We hope that Senator Ligarda, who is present at this hall today, can take this into account, because really we must stop this anomalous practice, and in order to show our disappointment over the manner in which the NCMF has been conducting its affairs, may we therefore propose suggest to the chair of our Committee on Finance to suspend all deliberations on this NCMF budget, or if the hearings have already been terminated, that no committee report from the Committee on Finance will include the budget of the NCMF.
Mr. President.
Senator Ligarda.
Since I was mentioned by the Senate President Pro Tem as chair of the Committee on Finance, let me just inform the body that the Vice Chair in charge of the National Commission on Muslim Filipinos, Senator Lacson, has already conducted a hearing and approved in the hearing, subject to plenary discussions in November, the budget of the National Commission on Muslim Filipinos. So unless you want it recalled, or you could ask those questions during the plenary discussion. So what is the pleasure of the gentleman
well,
from
Iloilo? That's why we do not know the status. But certainly, even if the hearings have been terminated,
yes,
and the matter has already been submitted, there is no committee report yet,
yes,
that has been submitted to the chamber, and therefore we are suggesting,
yes,
subject to the sound discretion of the chairman of the Committee on Finance, not to include in the meantime the budget of the NCMF when the committee submits its report to plenary, just to show the displeasure of the chamber on this nefarious practice, which affects the very integrity of a document which identifies one as a Filipino.
I take note of that. I join you in your indignation, as I'm sure all the members of this chamber do. We will make the necessary provisions in the budget. I will consult with the Vice Chair as well and the LBRMO on how to proceed with this. And perhaps we could discuss this in our caucus on the budget scheduled for October 12. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Let me thank the gentleman from Bukidnon for so kindly answering our questions.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Senator Gordon wishes to interpolate, but he has gallantly acceded to allowing Senator Laila De Lima to first interpolate the gentleman from Bukidnon. So may we recognize Senator De Lima, Mr. President?
Senator De Lima is recognized for that purpose.
Thank you, Mr. President, and thank you, Senator Gordon. Will the gentleman from yield to just a few, two to three questions? The gentleman mentioned.
May I make a suggestion, Mr. President? Maybe the podium of the lady senator could. We can ask the page if you can turn it.
Okay.
Naman mapivot yan pa rin.
Maybe can she can use the one in the middle.
Ay, ito, ma'am. Ito na, sir. I'm sorry then. Yeah. Okay. Old school. My apologies.
The majority leader advised us against turning my back to the Senate President. And I think that is just proper procedure that is good decorum. Just a few questions for the gentleman from Bukidnon. You have mentioned only 177 Indonesians in the August 18.
Yes, ma'am.
Although I got it from a news report that actually it is 500 to 700 Indonesians who reportedly went to Mecca using Philippine passports.
That's correct.
My source is Philippine Star, PhilStar, September 9, 2016. So does the gentleman confirm that his own information is that it's 500 to 700 Indonesians?
Yes, Mr. President. With the investigation that we've done, it's over 500 Indonesians. So between 500 to 700 is the correct assumption.
And as a matter of fact, out of the 500 to 700 Indonesians, 177 are under investigation.
Yes,
they were apprehended.
Yes, Madam.
You mentioned only the National Bureau of Investigation as the lead agency in the ongoing investigation into this scandal. But does the gentleman know that actually the Department of Justice has a 16-man panel investigating the same matter, headed by a senior prosecutor? Would the gentleman know about that?
I just get most of my reports from the newspaper articles that we've read so far. If there's a DOJ panel that's in charge of that, then we welcome that development.
And that I would suppose that there has been no update yet on the ongoing investigation by the 16-man panel of the DOJ?
Not of my knowledge.
And does the gentleman also know that, again, based on reports, the 177 Indonesians apprehended and the subject of that investigation were actually released on recognizance to the Indonesian embassy without objection from the Department of Justice?
I believe it was during the trip of the president to Indonesia with President Widodo, that President Widodo requested that the Indonesians be treated fairly, and I think the president acceded to that. Mr. President.
The release on recognizance of those under investigation.
Yes, Mr. President.
So that's actually with executive imprimatur.
Yes, Mr. President.
Is that the understanding of the gentleman?
Yes, Mr. President.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator De Lima. Senator Gordon is recognized for interpellation.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. Mr. President, will the gentleman, a good friend, Senator Zubiri, yield for a few questions?
I will be honored to yield to my chairman of the Philippine Red Cross, Mr. President, and a distinguished member of this chamber.
Thank you very much. Mr. President, I just want to first give a manifestation just to make sure that
we also give credit to Nancy Binay, our senator from Makati, and both Senator Soto has requested me to do so, because Senator Binay had already
filed a resolution,
asked that this be a resolution to directing the accountability of public officers and investigations to conduct an inquiry in aid of legislation. And I'm happy that there's a 1-2 punch here. A resolution was filed, and then a privileged speech was made by Senator Sabiri, which I think explains the whole matter correctly. And I just wanted to let the public know that the Senate is on top of the situation. And I just thought Senator Binay just mentioned to me casually, and I thought I'd mention it here. Mr. President, there are, correct me if I'm wrong, Indonesia is the biggest country, Muslim population, has the biggest Muslim population in the whole world. And because of that, I would imagine, does a gentleman think that based on that, and so being so near and so proximate, and knowing that there's a visa-free scenario for all ASEAN members into our country and each other's countries, I would imagine, and don't you think, that our DFA and our immigration and all those should be wary of the fact that there is a very big backlog for Indonesians to go to the Hajj. In fact, although we have 8,000, the waiting list for Indonesia is 37 years. Do you agree with me? It's 37 years. So which means if there is a 37-year backlog from Indonesia, that means a lot of people may die without getting to the Hajj, and they would try to move heaven and earth to try and get a visa from no matter what country would provide that. But it just so happens that the Philippines seems to be a perfect patsy for that. It is near, and obviously they have connections here. Don't you think we should have asked them to do that? Or I think that should be part of our investigation, to require the DFA and all these other agencies to have a watch list to make sure that all these countries that have a long line of people who are going to go to Hajj be on the watch list, so that we could be careful.
The only problem there, Mr. President, I agree with you 100%, but the only problem is because of our visa-free travel with ASEAN countries. It's very difficult to distinguish between someone who wants to go to Boracay and somebody who wants to go to Hajj pilgrimage. So, the question there would probably be with the DFA officials or the Bureau of Immigration officials. It would be their call, probably.
I'm just trying to pinpoint where the Blue Ribbon, all of us practically are members of the Blue Ribbon, should focus our investigation on, so we could have a very brisk. This is really an open and shut case, but we really have to find out who is accountable. Yes. For an example, Office of Muslim Affairs is supposed to provide an endorsement. Isn't that correct?
Yes, it's now called the National Commission of Muslim Affairs.
That's correct. And yes. It would appear that they have been overly liberal, because not only are they supposed to issue that certificate, they're also required to come up with a certificate of tribal affiliation, whether they are from a particular area, like Maguindanao, or Maranao, or they are Tausug.
Yes, that's correct, that correct, Mr. President.
And if you look at also, they would, some of the requirements, they would have to need a birth affidavit that they are from our country, etc.
Yes, Mr. President.
And in fact, they would need a personal appearance guarantee form signed by the OMA, by the
NCMF.
Yes,
Mr.
That's
President.
Correct. So do you think that these things are not being followed sufficiently?
As you can see, Mr. President, as already divulged earlier by Senator De Lima, that this year alone, the estimates are over 500 to almost 700 Indonesians were given this they're genuine documents obtained erroneously, or they were
Philippine passports.
Philippine passports. These are genuine documents, sir.
Yeah.
And at the tune of 10 to 12,000 U.S. dollars. Mr. President.
That's correct. And they give, if memory serves correct, they are, the travel agents, our cost is 25,000 pesos.
Yes, sir.
Di ba?
Yes, sir.
25,000 lang ang binabayad, but they make a handsome profit out of this. And because
$10,000, Your Honor.
That was
admitted by the Indonesians that were apprehended.
That's right. And the investment is 25,000 pesos. So you can see that this is why all our radar should be, all our government radar should be focused on this, because I'm sure this is not the first time this has happened. Nahuli lang ito ngayon.
Nahuli lang po.
That's correct. Having said that, I wonder if some of our colleagues will help me, because my legal knowledge has become, you know, very hazy. Would this not be in the matter of unequal protection of laws, that you provide a Hajj passport for 7 months, and a particular group of Filipinos are allowed to get a special passport? This is a Hajj passport, Your Honor. They only give this it's good for 7 months. And because of the unique nature of the situation, it's non-renewable and may not be used as the basis for the issuance of a regular passport.
May I just clarify also what Senator Gordon is saying? The information that was given to me was they were Hajj passports and regular passports. It was a mix. So they also have regular Philippine passports that were fake.
So it's a Philippine passport that is fixed. But actually, the predicate is that it is a Hajj passport, because that is what they're given 7 months, and they may not be used. It's not renewable. That's what I'm trying to clarify.
Yes, you can use the regular passport or the Hajj passport.
Mr.
President.
There is two passports. So that would be in the nature of an equal protection, because a regular Filipino has to go and line up, and here, out of our liberality, we're giving a certain group of Filipinos a special passport, because there is a big requirement to go to the Hajj, spiritual requirement. Would this also be in the nature of a violation of separation of church and state?
On the issuance of a Hajj passport, probably, but on those we issued with fake.
Because the passport is being issued to a particular religious sect, if you will, which, you know, cannot a Catholic now ask for a special passport to go to Rome,
for Camino
to go to Medjugorje, or to go to Spain, to go and do the, to go to.
I believe, Mr. President, Saudi, the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, KSA, made this special request a long time ago, and that's what we need to be clarified. Was that a country-to-country agreement? Was that an old treaty that maybe escaped us?
I guess this is something that we would have to find out.
Yes,
in the committee.
Have to find out.
No, because this
request
is
ng Saudi Arabia, magkakaroon din sila ng
we really have to peel this problem out. No, meaning you know, unfolded. At the same time, this during these times would even constitute a national security threat to us, especially because of the fact there are many ramifications. One is the restraining being undertaken allegedly by some Indonesian radical units, or even Malaysian radical units, or for that matter, other radical units from Afghanistan, or for that matter, ISIS, that could now be able to obtain a Philippine passport and drive a truck in Nice or in Cannes and start, you know, rampaging and killing people, and then it turns out to be a Filipino when he really is not a Filipino. It would also show the weakness of the fiber of the integrity of our governmental institutions, that we are there able to get passports, and therefore it would also embarrass every Filipino traveling, because now their questions will be asked. They can be set aside, Mr. President. Is this not correct?
That's correct, Mr. President. It's an embarrassment to the foreign affairs community. As a matter of fact, we're now because of what has happened, we're now in a lookout bulletin in most countries because of the presence of fake passports and travel documents given by Filipino organized crime syndicates.
Mr. President, about a couple of weeks ago, I wanted to stand up on a question of personal privilege and collective privilege, because a grandnephew of mine, who is a scholar at the Ateneo, went to Malaysia.
And he was with a group going to a religious event there, a spiritual event, if you will. He was set aside at the secondary airport in Malaysia, and practically his passport was confiscated and said, your passport is not good. And they confiscated his phone and they put him in jail together with so many other nationalities of other people. And were it not for the fact that my sister was able to call my other sister in Washington, because the husband of my niece in Washington was given the same kind of treatment in Malaysia. And so I thought, if this is being done to all kinds of Filipinas, I thought I would deliver a privileged speech and call the attention and issue a note verbal, once again, to a friendly country and tell them that their people are mocking or gouging many travelers. In fact, my grandnephew saw people paying them off, and they were not even fed until he was fetched by the member of the embassy, whom I asked, and I thank the ambassador of Malaya, of the Philippines to Malaya, who immediately acted. There was another Filipino there who was incarcerated, and I said, you better make sure that you help the other Filipino who was incarcerated at that time. But this is the kind of thing that will happen to many Filipino travelers. If they have a Philippine passport, they will not look at it with respect. These are government papers. These are papers that assure other countries that this indeed is a Filipino citizen. And because we are so cavalier in issuing these passports, a lot of our Filipinos will suffer, especially the OFWs. God knows how many forms of indignities our people are exposed to. In fact, at one time when I was about 10 years ago, when I was traveling to Guam, there was an old lady going through Guam, and she was set aside by the American Immigration Commissioner and being insulted, and I stood up and I said, you cannot do that. I want to talk to your supervisor. But you know, dinuduro tayo eh. And you know, we have to stand up every time our documents are, this is not forged. People are within the agency authorized to do so, are doing so. So I would like to commend the gentleman from Bukidnon as well as the gentle lady from Makati that they were quick enough to come up and with this resolution. And let me assure our colleagues, and I'm sure our colleagues will be participating here because practically all of us are members of the Blue Ribbon Committee. I hope that we can do our homework and do this very fast. And I'm glad Senator Dulongan also advised our distinguished gentle lady handling finance to make sure that we put a stop to this. When I was Secretary of Tourism, I would even be asked, Your Honor, to provide money for pamasahe for many of our Muslim compatriots. And there would always be somebody who would be lobbying for that. And I would have to ask Malacanang, is this authorized? Using PTA money for that sort of thing. Philippine Tourism, and it's not. So you can see, there is developing a sense of entitlement, which I think our brother Muslims, most of them want not to do. But there are a certain group of people who are really trying to make money out of the misery of other people. In this case, so many Indonesians, 37-year waiting line, are now going to the Philippines to use corruption to corrupt our people and pay them handsome amounts of money just to get to the Hajj. So, Mr. President, I assure the gentleman and all our colleagues here, and I invite them all to be very active in this investigation. This is very, very important that the gentleman from Bukidnon and the gentle lady from Makati have put out, and to get the attention of no less than the Senate President Pro Tempore, who I saw was shocked, and I'm equally shocked as well, and all the others, including Senator De Lima, I think we should really push with a very, very quick resolution of this matter. Thank you very much, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. President. And just to add, Mr. President, what saddens me the most is I'm the principal, together with your father, Mr. President. It was your father, Senate, he was minority floor leader then. We both co-authored, principally sponsored the NCMF, the National Commission for Muslim Filipinos. So it saddens me to find out that we tried to come up with a better agency for our Muslim brothers, graduating them from the mere office to now a national commission similar to the setup with the National Commission for Indigenous Peoples. And during our deliberations, we kept insisting, together with your father, that they should stop already all these racketeering issues of all these rackets and all these corruption schemes that was hounding the agency. And it became worse, because before, if they were selling travel kits with a very high fees, together with passport issuances of tickets, with one particular agency, of course, controlled by the heads of the OMA. Now it is even worse. It's fraudulent documents utilizing genuine Filipino passports and birth certificates, etc., etc. They graduated to a higher level, Mr. President. It's now become organized criminal activity. So I really hope and pray that the Senate President, together with all our members, help us unsolve and unravel this organized criminal syndicate and put them behind bars, and finally come up with a policy statement for NCMF and the DFA that this will never happen again. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Majority Leader.
Definitely the issue begs to be investigated. I move that we refer the speech of Senator Zubiri and the succeeding interpellations to the Committee on Accountability of Public Officers, Mr. President.
There is a motion to refer the speech of Senator Zubiri and the interpellation thereon to the Accountability Committee. Is there any objection? Hearing none, the motion is approved.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move that we proceed with the reference of business.
Is there any objection? There being none, the motion is approved.
Bills on first reading. 1189, an act promoting positive and nonviolent discipline of children, prohibiting all forms of corporal punishment, humiliating and degrading treatment, appropriating funds therefore and for other purposes, by Senator Risa Hontiveros.
Referred to the Committees on Women, Children, Family Relations and Gender Equality and Finance.
1190, an act establishing a national mental health policy for the purpose of enhancing the delivery of integrated mental health services, promoting and protecting persons utilizing psychiatric, neurologic, and psychosocial health services, appropriating funds therefore and for other purposes, Senator Risa Hontiveros.
The Committees on Health and Demography and Finance.
1191, an act to regulate the rational exploration, development, and utilization of mineral resources, and to ensure the equitable sharing of benefits for the state, indigenous peoples, and local communities, and for other purposes, Senator Grace Poe.
To the Committees on Environment and Natural Resources, Cultural Communities, Ways and Means, and Finance.
1192, an act to give juridical personality to the present Veterans Memorial Medical Center, and for other purposes, Senator Richard Gordon.
To the Committees on Government, Corporations and Public Enterprises, Health and Demography and Finance.
Resolution number 191, resolution expressing the full support and active participation of the Senate of the Philippines in the observance of the World Teachers Day, by Senator Zubiri.
To the Committee on Rules.
Communications, letters from the Banco Central ng Pilipinas, transmitting to the Senate copies of the following certified and authenticated BSP issuances in compliance with Section 15A of Republic Act Number 7653, Circular Number 926, dated 13 September 2016, and Circular Letter Number CL-2016077, dated 14 September 2016.
To the Committee on Banks, Financial Institutions, and Currencies.
Mr. President.
Majority Leader.
Pursuant to Section 33 of Republic Act 8436, as amended by Republic Act 9369, otherwise known as the Automated Election System, I'd like to manifest the following members of the Senate to the Joint Congressional Oversight Committee on Automated Election System. For the majority, Senator Laila De Lima as chair, members Pangilinan Binay Villar, and for the minority, Recto Trillanes Escudero.
The manifestation of the Senate contingent to the Joint Congressional Oversight Committee on the Automated Election System is noted.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'd like to manifest the following senators to constitute the members of the Joint Congressional Oversight Committee on the Comprehensive Tax Reform Program under Republic Act 8240, as amended. For the majority, Senator Angara as chair, members Pangilinan, Hontiveros, Villanueva, and for the minority, Recto.
The Senate contingent to the Joint Congressional Oversight Committee on the Comprehensive Tax Reform Program is noted.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'd like to manifest the following senators to constitute as members of the Joint Congressional Oversight Committee on the Official Development Assistance under Republic Act 8182. Senator Angara as chair and members Drilon, Zubiri, Legarda, Gatchalian. For the minority, Recto Escudero.
The manifestation of the Senate panel to the Joint Congressional Oversight on the Official Development Assistance is hereby noted.
I'd like to manifest the following senators constitute as members of the Joint Congressional Oversight Committee on the Tax Incentives Management and Transparency Act under Republic Act number 10708. For the majority, Senator Angara, chair, members Subiri, Drilon, Legarda, and for the minority, Recto.
The Senate contingent to the Joint Congressional Oversight Committee on the Tax Incentive Management and Transparency Act is hereby noted.
And finally, to manifest, Mr. President, the following senators to constitute as members of the Joint Congressional Customs and Tariff Oversight Committee under Republic Act 10863. Senator Angara as chair, members Ejercito, Villanueva, Legarda, for the minority, Recto, Mr. President.
The manifestation of the Senate contingent to the Customs and Tariff Oversight Committee is hereby noted.
Mr. President, I move to adjourn the session until 3 o'clock in the afternoon of Tuesday, October 11, 2016.
Is there any objection? There being none, the session is adjourned until 3 o'clock in the afternoon of Tuesday, October 11, 2016.